to start us off, we have Laura, who's going to tell us about jet mode AGN feedback.
Thank you for inviting me. I'm going to tell you about AGN feedback, here, and the progress made in this field in the last 10 years. I'll start with Chandra X-ray Observatory and finish with LOFAR. From Chandra X-ray Observatory, we are able to study AGN feedback in the most massive system, the City Galaxy at the center of the group and cluster. This is known as the jet mode AGN feedback. However, while Chandra resolution is very good for studying the inner part of the group and cluster, it is not suitable for survey or studying diffuse emission at higher redshift. As a result, I'll present the importance that LOFAR can have in studying AGN feedback higher redshift, possible as high as 2 and above. However, I will start, since this is the first talk in this topic, I will start with the big pictures. The AGN feedback in the galaxy formation matters. And one of the most cited phrases in the introduction of the galaxy formation paper is, what role do the black hole have in shaping the galaxy around them? And observationally, it was found that the black hole masses scale with the bulge masses, what is known as the Magorian relation, or with the velocity dispersion. However, from this plot, you can tell if the black hole and the galaxy they form in the same time, or if the black hole is a byproduct of the galaxy formation. But from long time, it's an argument in the literature, the energy release by the formation of the black hole is more than enough to unbind the galaxy. And also, it was found observationally that the mechanical energy by the radio lobe, it's enough to offset the cooling, what is known the cooling flow problem. And I'll discuss about this through my talk. But furthermore, the AGN feedback is very important in the galaxy formation model to understand how cooling is truncated in massive galaxies. And now I will start with the AGN feedback and introduce the radiative mode and the jet mode feedback. This is just to set my path towards the jet mode AGN feedback. And then I will tell you about the site of the jet mode AGN feedback, the galaxy cluster, especially the cooling flow clusters. And I will go to the scaling relation between the mechanical power and the radio power. And I will finish with the prospect for studying the AGN feedback at high redshift with the new generation radio telescopes. Let me to start with the two modes. First, there is a mode of accretion at a low rate of Eddington limit, which creates radiative efficient AGN. This mode of accretion is met at a high redshift system, most effective redshift 2 or 3, or the space density of quasar peaks also. And this mode of accretion creates luminous radiation in the form of wind or galactic outflow. And these galactic outflow are found for radio galaxy, quasar, starburst galaxies. And we will hear about all of this after the tea break. And the feedback is thought to operate here by moving the cold gas around using this galactic wind. However, there are lots of caveats, and you'll hear in this kind of mode, separate the star formation wind from AGN winds, etc. And I'm showing the schematic of the radiative mode AGN feedback. Here are the winds created by this geometrically thin, optically thick accretion disk. And also, as we heard to this talk a lot, like Martin said, the separation is not clear and necessary, but yeah, it's useful. We have radio loud AGN and radio quiet AGN. And as Martin was telling us, the radio loud AGN in the radiative mode are the high efficiency radio galaxy. And some of these hergs are also, they have a powerful radio emission. And from the orientation angle, they can be type 1 quasar with broad line, or type 2 with strong narrow lines. There is also a mode of accretion at low Eddington limit, which creates advection dominates accretion flow or radiative inefficient accretion flow. And from the And in this mode of accretion, it's in the kinetic mode by two-sided jets, and from orientation angle, they are known as low excitation radio galaxy with FR1 type morphology. And this kind of the sources are found at present epoch in a galaxy with hot halos. I'm showing an example. One of the cluster in blue is the hot gas, the X-ray, in red is the radion. Like I said, this mode of accretion black hole, it's accreting well below Eddington limit. And jet mode AGN feedback got a burst of the discovery by Chandra of many of these X-ray cavity in the environment of nearby clusters. And the cavity are interpreted as bubble created by the central AGN, which rise buoyantly to the present location. But they allow us to calculate the energy budget of the AGN feedback. And I'll start with the I'll continue with the location of the jet mode AGN feedback, the galaxy clusters. And the cooling flow problem. In the originally proposed scenario by Fabian 1994, the gas is heating to high temperature 10 to the 7 by the initial gravitational collapse on galaxy group and cluster form. But in the case of the galaxy clusters, the gas cools slowly and the quasi-hydrostatic equilibrium form with temperature of the gas close to the Virial temperature. However, in the case of some galaxy clusters, the temperature is decreasing, the density is increasing, and there's been the cooling time is less than the Hubble time. And then you'll have a cooling flow. However, the searches in the optical for these high rates of star formation, we should correlate with high mass deposition rates, fail. And in optical, they find some star formation, which today is called residual star formation. And also, when you look with the new generation X-ray telescope as XMM Newton with high spectral resolution, they didn't find cooling below 2 keV. This means the cooling lines are missing from the data. This means you don't have iron 70. And also this means they suppose that a source of heating is operated. And Chandra with the high spatial resolution reveal strong coupling between the AGN and the intercluster medium, these cavities, which are filled with the radio emissions. And I will show you the schematic picture, our simplified version of the radio mode AGN feedback. The cavity are hitting the intercluster medium. This means that the gas cool to the gas condensations. Some of the gas go into the star formation. Some accrete black on the supermassive black hole. As a result, a new AGN feedback loop starts to another AGN outburst. By AGN feedback, we mean there is a connection between the cold gas and the AGN, such as if the cooling increases, the heat from the AGN will increase to compensate. And from here to my talk, I will discuss about the heating part, and you will hear also from in the talks follow about the cold state. And in addition to the cavities, it's not so simple. In addition to the cavities, as everybody knows, in addition to the cavities, there are also shocks, sound waves, mixings. And I'm showing one of the most luminous system, Perseus, with a very deep Chandra observation. And you can see two sets of cavity, and you can see lots of structure, shocks, sound waves, etc. And also, besides X-bubble shock and cavity, there are cosmic rays. Cosmic rays are thought to be injected at the tip of the radio jet, and when the jets move supersonically, some of the cosmic rays escape and hit the intercluster medium. All of these processes, they create a convective core, and which will transport the energy inside the cluster core. And also, besides the heating by AGN, can be also some non-AGN heating as conduction or slashing. For example, I'm showing another cluster, ABLE 2052. In the corner is the inner part of the cluster, where are the the cavities we fill with the blue, the radio emission, and is the large-scale slashing motion. This means slashing means you have a minor merger between a galaxy and the central BCG. However, why everybody is agreeing that the AGN at the center of the cluster has an important role in regulated cooling in this system, many details of the AGN heating and cooling are still poor understood. And in the next talk, we'll hear more from this theoretical point of view and how they are able to understand. It is thought that, for example, Banerjee and Sarma, they are saying that you can explain heating by turbulence induced by the cavity, or Socker at all, they say it's mixing induced by the cavity. That means there are lots of components. Also, you have conduction, you have, you have conduction, you have claw clamps, you have shock cavity, all of these, and you have to understand how all of these participate to the big pictures. And there are lots of papers in this topic. And also, how the gas cool onto the supermassive black hole, like Lee and Brian. But from the X-ray data, Chandra, using the more luminous system, we can measure. We are able to measure cavities, and I will elaborate how we get the heating ray by cavities. From the X-ray image, we measure the cavity by eye. We measure the distance from the center of the cluster to the present location, and we measure the cavity sizes. Having this, we can calculate the volume, and by fitting the data with one temperature plasma plus galactic absorption, we get the density, and then assuming that the cavities are in pressure equilibrium with the ICM, we measure the pressures. Having this, we can calculate the cavity enthalpy, which gives the estimate of the energy required to create them, and then assuming that the cavity rises buoyantly to the present location, we can calculate the cavity power. Once we have this information, we can try to understand if heating by cavity is energetically feasible in a balancing cooling. I'll show you the cavity power versus the heating, the cooling that has to be balanced by heating. For a sample of system from Rafferty 2006, Rafferty et al., from Chandra archive, and he's showing that at least 50% of the system have enough energy to balance cooling. And then we also did complete samples, like B55 or high flux, and we see a percentage of 65%, a number of 65% of cooling flow have detected cavity. But as I keep mentioning, the Chandra allows us to measure cavity in the most luminous systems. As a result, you don't have an understanding of the AGN feedback at high redshift, which are critical inputs for galaxy formation and evolution. And in order to alleviate this topic, most of my early research, my PhD research, was focused on finding a relation between the radio power and the cavity power to be used as a proxy to derive cavity power. And we did this. We used both X-ray and the radio. The X-ray, you get the cavity power. The radio, you get the bolometric radio luminosity. And then we plotted cavity power versus the bolometric radio luminosity. This is, again, for the system 124 system. And we got VLA observation at four frequencies. And we see that there is a wide range between the cavity power and the bolometric radio luminosity. This ratio ranges between few and few thousands. However, the average, the median is around 100, which agree with the theory, and the older cavity tend to have higher ratios. And also because we have more frequency, we took an account also the spectral break, and then we find a much tighter relation. Here I have upper limits because the lowest frequency is 330 megahertz. As a result, we're not able to constrain the break frequency for all of them, and LOFAR can improve a lot in this topic. And also we did the relation between the cavity power and the monochromatic radio luminosity because to be used for survey like NVSS, for example, etc. And there are lots of signs with this kind of relation, from finding the AGN jet power to an individual system to using a huge large of sample like BEST et al. And but But like I mentioned, it is important to understand AGN feedback at high redshift, because at high redshift the galaxy formation is more important, and AGN feedback is more instrumental in understanding it. However, the only systematic study with redshift 0.5 was done by Hlavacek Larando 2012 using the massive cluster survey. This means it may be biased towards the most luminous systems, and was found no evolution in AGN feedback in this study up to redshift 0.5, and no cool core in 400 SD ROSA survey by Viklin in 2007. However, high Z is not easy to study with the current X-ray instruments. The resolution, the cosmological dimming, small field of view, and also there may be a quasar in the center, etc. Also, when you go to even higher redshift, was found no evolution up to redshift 1.3, means the AGN feedback start to operate as early as 7 giga here after the feedback and does not change since then, keeping the same balance between heating and cooling as in the local universe. However, most of these relations, they rely on studying AGN feedback based on the scaling relations. And it is important, if we really want to go to really, really, really deep high redshift, it is important to understand if this scaling relation apply considering the different the evolution of different population of AGN. And I will show this later. But the new instruments, LOFAR, SKA, can help in understanding this. And I will tell you about what the science can do with LOFAR. And LOFAR, it's a new era radio telescope. It's a low frequency array. It's based mainly in Netherlands, 46 stations there, and 9 outside Netherlands. And one of them, it's in Hamburg. It has two bands, the low band, 1080, and the high band. And what can LOFAR do for the AGN feedback? First, all sky survey, which is already started to operate, and targeted observation from now on, can better constrain the energetically dominant electron, and finally can improve and expand on the scaling relation. And in the future, I'm guessing, sometimes we can do the really deep small area survey low frequency to probe faint lurks in the cluster environment. And now I'm coming back to the evolution of AGN population science. It's important for the deep fields studies. I'm showing the number of sources per square degree per redshift bin above 1 millijansky at 140 megahertz. And it's telling you that at this fluxes, you have to separate the radio loud AGN from the star forming galaxy and the radio quiet quasars. However, also the Hergs, they are the most powerful radio sources. They are usually located at a cluster or high redshift. As a result, they may have a quasar in the center, and they may go mainly to the radiative mode feedback or not. We have to find that. And but we are interested in studying the low luminosity lurks. And this plot shows you that you can find low luminosity lurks as 100 at redshift 1 per square degree, and tens of them at redshift 5 per square degrees. And LOFAR has the advantage of low frequency, more sensitive to deep spectrum, but higher, also high redshift system. And the cluster, the sources at the center of the cluster, they tend to be steep spectrum sources in general, and they have the large field of view, more suitable for a survey. As a result, we will have a statistically significant sample to study AGN feedback at higher redshift. And right now, I'm trying to understand AGN feedback using deep field by 10-hour integration per field. Not that we'll understand AGN feedback up to redshift 1.5. And why this? Why NEP, Cosmos, XMLSS? First, with only few LOFAR pointings, you are able to get like 200 cluster to study AGN feedback. And NEP is the largest contiguous survey In the left side, I'm showing the color-coded image from ROSAT. It's showing you the multitude of clusters in this field. It's a supercluster environment. And there are the contours from the how they name it, NEP wide, NEP deep, the optical surveys and the Herschel coverage. This is important if you want to really go to the high to a very deep observation. These things get important. And in the right side, I'm showing that the fields, the NEP and the cosmos, they complement. They fill a different region in the LX versus Z space. A cosmos, it's a smaller field, but it's deeper. That means you'll find more low luminosity, high redshift systems. And our goal is by using these fields, in addition with the LOFAR, in addition with radio data, to calculate if the local derivatives scaling relation apply to till redshift one. And then in the future, LOFAR and SKA, this is it's a good topic for SKA also, to what redshift AGN continue to balance cooling, redshift 5, for example, but you need very deep, small area survey. And because of the multi-frequency coverage, Cosmos perhaps is the best choice. And to observe the so-called 1.4 microjoule population, well, you have to account for different evolution of this population. And then you'll study AGN feedback using LOFAR as a proxy. Also having such a good data set, it's important to understand the interplay between radio mode and jet mode feedback. So far, there are few attempts in this topic. Now I will give you some flavor on the LOFAR calibration. I'm showing here the NEP field at 150 megahertz. This is the image after the first global calibration. As you can see, there are lots of errors around the bright sources. This means when you are doing, and this is not true just because this become important for every LOFAR observation. When you are doing a LOFAR observation, you have to correct for direction-dependent effects from ionosphere and errors in the B model. And this was already shown in Reynolds Van Veeren paper from 2015. This means you have to loop over facets performing self-calibration, and he was showing that you need between 300 and 100 facets to achieve the thermal noise. And right now, LOFAR, it's in the stage that it's developing the package for the reduction to be done almost completely automatically. And this work is done by a group of people, and they are developing the factor package, which is completely automated. And I'm showing here the results from the factor package on one of the fields. Yeah, thank you. One of the facets and how LOFAR image improve. This means it's a huge improvement. You have to do direction-dependent calibration, and the noise gets improved by a factor of 5 just from one direction here. And I'm giving you some flavor of the kind of science we're doing with this field. This means with in the NEP field, we look at the correspondence between the cluster and the radio sources, and these are the kind of sources you are finding at higher redshift. This means LOFAR is starting; they're small, but they are starting to get resolved by LOFAR 5 arcsecond resolution. And for example, this source RAJ1746, it's a redshift 0.386. And the Branchesi in 2006, they didn't find in their deeper VLA image, they didn't find any emission at this cluster location, but appear unresolved in the VLSS. This is nice because then we can get the spectral index estimate, which is 2.5 for this source. This means, yeah, having this kind of sources, yeah, we are trying to study AGN feedback. And I'll give you my summary. This means X-ray cavity shocks are the direct evidence of jet mode feedback in the massive system. They allow us to measure feedback and understand the relation to radio power. But this study can be done only for the most luminous systems. And from now on, the study of Gemmode feedback at high redshift will have to rely on the radio data and the available X-ray data, the density, pressure, for whatever you can get for a high redshift cluster. And the LOFAR HBA is providing the first result for the deep fields, and there are other people working in different fields in different topics, like we've heard to this talk. But we are trying to understand AGN feedback first using NEP Cosmos XMLSS 10-hour integration, not very deep, and the LOFAR World Sky Survey between 0, 3, and 1. And then in the future, SKA and LOFAR will finally try to break down and get us to the redshift 5 if it's possible. Thank you.
Thanks for keeping to time to the second, more or less. I just need to stop this timer. Thank you. Any questions? Oh, shut up. Questions? Yes.
Yep.
Over there. Yep.
Yeah. A number of sources, in particular the one you were showing, in X-ray radio image by McNamara et al. Show. Shocks surrounding these radio lobes. That means that they cannot be in pressure equilibrium with external medium, right?
Yeah, you're right.
So how, I mean, is the, if you took that into account, is that, and also simulation show that it's very difficult to get rid of shocks even when you switch off the source. Yeah. How would that affect the correlation you were showing?
You know, everybody did, from the beginning, everybody told us, you know, how can you believe the 4 PV or whatever? But even recently, it's even more easy to explain this. You know, there are so different ways to read the clusters. I think this estimate we got, it's a rough one. I agree with you, it's a very rough one, but it's just a flavor, and because the simulation that they will show us, yeah, you can hit the cluster in so many different ways that we are not worried that we are, yeah.
Have you checked that the correlation persists? I mean, have you checked that?
I think
taking into account the pressure difference.
We didn't do it in that time, it's true, but we can talk about that, yeah.
So if you want to take into account shocks, you know, there are models which give the estimates of the ratio between the lobe energy and the shock energy, and it would just change essentially the prefactor 4.
Yeah, it's the only thing that the 4 is
more like 6.
It's just scaling, yeah.
Yeah.
DN by DZ plot for different classes of AGNs. You had RQQs on there. This was a plot by, I think, Best, you said?
Okay, the evolution of the radio source.
Yeah, so did the RQQs include the obscured objects? Do you know?
I think so, yeah. Okay. Yeah. Because from my point of view, yeah, it's actually, get it.
You know, yes.
You mentioned about your work in calculating the jet mechanical power from the cavity, right? Okay. So and then relating it to the radio luminosity. So people in this community have been using the Carvaniolo relations. So has your work any updates on that, or it's kind of matches?
Yeah, you know that Carvaniolo, it's a continuation of I didn't show his relation, but he's going to the, it's adding to the plot more groups, more elliptical. That means he's trying to go to, you know, to see if the low hand of the plot will affect the slope, and he found that they agree. Yeah.
Okay, we need to move on. Let's thank Nora again.